Good morning. Welcome to day two. Hey, yeah, all right. That's energy. I'm a little wired. We did the 5K this morning, and it was good. Was anybody here there? Wow. Yeah, well, nah, that's all right. You guys are all here on time.
Yeah.
All right, so we're going to get started. Got a kind of a cool session we put together this morning. We know a lot of people come to these things and they're new to Jamf software, they're new to Mac management, and you start looking on Jamf Nation and everyone sees all this stuff about, oh, just write this script and check out my GitHub and you know all this kind of stuff. And yeah, right? You see that. And we know, you know, it takes a little bit and you got to get into it. Sometimes I think a lot of folks out there assume that everybody kind of does this. And does all this scripting stuff all the time. And so what we wanted to do is say, well, let's break this down and let's start from the absolute beginning and show you some of the things that you should know and kind of how to get started with this. With that, Brock's going to go through. This is Brock Walters, ladies and gentlemen. Go through this, and then we should have some time for Q&A at the end. And we'll kind of see how it goes. Yeah.
Cool. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming. What we're going to talk about today is command line interface basics. And what we mean by basics is really basics. If anyone has come to this session with the idea that they're going to enhance their skills that they already have in terms of command line use in terms of scripting, you are in for perhaps 45 minutes to an hour of bitter disappointment, because we are going to be talking about extremely entry-level concepts and ideas. I can just tell you from my own personal experience as a systems administrator that I came into this career a little bit late in life, and I would have been so thrilled to have a session like this. So hopefully you guys, some of you at least, will be able to appreciate that aspect of it. We're talking about literally like, someone told me to use terminal and I have no idea what that means or what to do. That's kind of where we're going here. That's me. That's a highly idealized version of me. And this is what I actually look like. And that's Cam. Cam is the Director of Education Services at Jamf Software. I am an education services engineer. I go out and teach our certification classes. So. And I know that some of you probably may have been through our certification classes, or if you are interested in certification classes, definitely check out the website. There's a lot of information up there about taking our classes and about getting additional training. So our objectives for this session are understanding terminal, understanding what terminal is, what you can do with it at its most basic level, navigating the file system in terminal, and this is something that really causes a lot of headaches for people. And it's something that people really, I think, struggle with. So hopefully we'll show some examples of how to do that, some very, very basic commands that should give you what you need to know to actually get around in the file system using the terminal interface. We'll talk a little bit, we're not gonna get too deep into this, but we'll talk a little bit about some common tasks that you might do, file manipulation, changing permissions. We'll talk a little bit on that. And we'll talk very, very briefly about automation, in other words, scripting. How do I take the commands that I've learned, put them together to actually create a script that does something? That's kind of where we're going here. Now, what you're seeing here, for those of you that are not familiar with the website HackerTyper, it's so great. It's one of my favorite things. You can literally just go onto the site HackerTyper and just start typing, and this gobbledygook shows up on your screen. So if you ever want to make your boss think you're doing something really awesome, just go to hackertyper.org and just pull up that. But to a lot of people, that's what scripting looks like. You know, I don't even know, that's probably Objective-C or Java, whatever. It's just a random assortment of code. And the reason I put that up there is because to a lot of people, when they see a script for the first time, it's like looking at a different language. Or maybe it's even worse. It's like looking at an ancient rune, right? You can look at a word in French or Italian, and maybe there's a cognate for it in English, and kind of get the idea what that means. But when you look at a Bash script, it's a completely foreign set of symbols and words that you literally may not have any idea how to confront. So hopefully we're going to demystify that a little bit, deflate some of that. We're also going to talk about the shell. The shell is your environment inside of the terminal application. It's what's referred to as a command line interpreter. The shell is what allows you to pass commands to the operating system to actually perform functions. There are many command line interpreters. In OS X, you can use Python, you can use Ruby. There are all sorts of different shells. The one we're going to be talking about is the default shell in OS X, which is Bash. Okay. Sorry. We're also going to be talking about executables and binaries. Executable files and binaries are kind of the core building blocks of Bash and scripting and the utilities that you use inside of Bash. So first, let's talk about terminal. What exactly is terminal? People say, oh, yeah, just open up terminal and do blah, 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 blah. And I'm sure a lot of you have confronted that, where you may have even done that. You may have used your Google Foo and gone out there, found some command that you knew was going to fix this one little problem that you had, and you may not have had any context for actually what that command did or what it was. How many of you have done that? Okay. Now, it's great in the moment. It's effective, right? But without having that context, you probably won't ever get any better at using the tool than just doing that. And when you're confronted with a problem of something that can't actually be solved by just going out and finding your little snippet of code on Google, what do you do? Hopefully, this will give you some ideas about that. But the terminal application is really just an OS X application found in the utilities folder that lets users access the operating system with the command line interface. That's all it is. Terminal is just basically a window to the command line interface. And let me just pause here for a moment and talk about the command line interface. Because what I want to do is kind of draw an analogy between using a computer and driving, right? My mom drove a car her whole life and never literally had any idea what the car was capable of doing. She barely understood the concept of putting gas in the car. It was a running joke in our family. You can drive a car your entire life and not have any intellectual curiosity about what's going on underneath the hood, right? You can use a computer in the same way. And the fact of the matter is that we're all here, we all have professional responsibilities due in part to the fact that Apple has built this genius set of metaphors around a very powerful computing system that allows people that don't need to know anything about computers to use a computer to actually do things in their daily job. Using terminal is a little bit more like getting under the hood, right? If you want to find what's going on underneath the hood, you want to find out a little bit about the fuel injector, the fuel pump, what the engine actually does, that's what the command line interface really is. It's a way of looking under the hood. So you can drive a car. That doesn't necessarily mean you know how to fix the car and what's actually happening inside. And that's hopefully what we're going to find out a little bit by talking about this stuff. That down there at the bottom is a file path. And I'm only introducing that at this point just in case you aren't familiar with the concept. That's what the path would look like in terminal to where the terminal application actually lives on the system. The top level directory where all the volumes live is called /volumes. Of course, we've got the Macintosh HD, which is the system volume for the computer. Inside of the applications folder, there's a folder called utilities. Inside of the utilities folder, there's an application called terminal. So that's a file path. Now, here's something that's kind of interesting. How many of you have pulled up a terminal window that looks like that? And how many of you have seen a terminal window that looks like that? How do you compensate for the differences? Well, one of the reasons you can assume that you can make them look different by just using the preferences in the terminal application itself, right? You've got the ability to change the opacity of the terminal window, the colorize the text, et cetera. But another thing that you can do is actually customize the shell environment itself, okay? We've already talked about the shell a little bit. The shell is a command line interpreter. In other words, it's the program that you use to enter commands. Another thing that the shell lets you do is customize the user environment. So you might end up with a shell that looks like this, where I've got colorized text that's giving me information about the operating system. Notice that this, and it might be hard to see, but this is actually my user's home folder. And inside of this folder, I have, of course, the downloads folder, the desktop folder, got my user library. There's some invisible folders. Those are the ones that start with dot. And then I've got files. The files are showing in that kind of green color. And I also have an executable file in here, a script. That's showing kind of a pinkish color. For those of you that were born after the internet was created, those of us that remember what it was like before the internet was around, colorized text is pretty awesome, right? I remember playing the text-based version of Oregon Trail. I know I'm totally dating myself. And when we finally got the colorized text in Oregon Trail, I was like, oh man, this is incredible. So what we're seeing here is just, it's hard to think sometimes how much information is actually being presented in this very simple format. But colorized text is your friend, for sure. A little bit more about the shell. As I mentioned, in OS X, the default shell or default command line interpreter is called, referred to as bash. That's kind of a portmanteau, a smushed together word, right, for the born again shell. The original shell was referred to as the born shell. The born again shell was a kind of a redo of that environment. This is kind of some computer guy humor, right? Lots of computer terminology is kind of like this, and we'll see that as we go along. Again, the analogy here, think back, I'm going to lay down some SAT type analogies on you. Bash is to the terminal application as Finder is to OS X, right? Bash is the environment which allows you to navigate through the file system, the same way that Finder does in OS X. It lets you open up Finder windows, open up new folders. Bash lets you enter commands. The same way Finder lets you do stuff to the computer, change your settings, etc. So the analogy is that Bash is inside the terminal application is your user environment, the same way that Finder is your user environment in the graphical user interface. Executables and binaries. So another definition here. An executable binary file triggered by a command interpreted by the shell causes the computer to perform a task or a set of tasks according to the instructions encoded in the binary file. So that's a very gobbledygook way of saying when you type a command for which there is an executable binary, you will be running the list of tasks inside that binary. That's really what a Unix utility is. When you run something like a CD or the man command or any command that you would enter into the bash shell, you're running a utility that's executing a set of instructions that live inside that binary. Bash has many built-in and available commands. The built-in commands are actually kind of built into the bash tool itself, the shell. And then the available commands are maybe more complicated utilities that can be called by the shell. And again, another analogy. An executable, or utility, they're sometimes referred to in Bash, is to Bash as an application is to OS X, right? You get Microsoft Word or whatever, so you can create a text document. You get Excel, so you can create a spreadsheet. Those are applications. That metaphor makes sense. A utility in Unix or in the shell is no different than that. You have a utility to perform a specific function that you need to handle inside your user environment. Okay? Here are some utilities. We've got man. This pulls up a manual page for bash commands. If you leave this room with no other piece of information, I want you to leave here knowing that every single bash utility, for the most part, has a manual, right? All you have to do is type man and the name of the utility you're trying to use, and you can read all sorts of helpful information about it. There's even a there's even a manual for bash for the shell itself, right? So if you type man, which is the command for the manual, and look at the bash shell, you will get all sorts of helpful information. I know this probably, I'm not expecting you to read the bash manual tonight, right? We want you all to be at First Avenue. But If you have some time, I urge you to read this manual because there is invaluable information in here about using the command line environment. Read totally fun manuals. Okay. There may be some other interpretations of this acronym, but manuals are cool. A lot of good information in them. We've got the which command. Discover the path where executable binaries live. The which command will actually tell you the path where the binaries are on the system. And again, we've already talked about file paths a little bit. The bash shell lives in a folder called bin. The man command lives in a folder called /bin. The which command lives in a folder called /bin as well. So that which command is just a utility that locates the binary files that are in the path of the shell. And this is a little bit more of a complex utility, but I want to cover it because I want to kind of give you the basics from the gamut, from really basic to something more complex. The diff command allows you to actually tell the differences between two different files on your computer. How many times have you been in this situation where you've got a text file on your desktop called something and a text file in your documents folder with the exact same name, and you don't know what the differences between those files are? Guess what? Your computer does know, because your computer can actually read the files. That's one of the kind of amazing things to grasp about what the shell does. The command line interpreter works at a very, very deep level. It actually can operate at the kernel level of the operating system. So if I use the diff command to make a comparison between the version of the hello.txt file on my desktop and the version of the hello.txt file in my documents folder, I actually get this result. It will read the file and tell me, oh, well, one of them has a line called hello and it has a line called goodbye. The other one only has the hello line in it. So the computer is actually reading the file. Now, it's a simple text file, and this is a very simple example. Diff actually has a lot more complex use cases than this, but diff is an amazing tool, and this is the kind of power that the bash shell has. When you start thinking along these lines, it's kind of an important and fundamental concept of Unix. Sorry if I have my back to the side of the room, didn't mean to do that. That everything on the operating system is a file. Does this make sense? Every application is a file. Every folder is a file. Every binary is a file. The naming conventions that are used, the paths, right, with the forward slashes, this is what's referred to as a namespace. And it's just that these files interact with each other because they all have different properties. That's a fundamental concept to Unix. The other thing we want to talk about in terms of navigating the file system is commands. So we'll take a look at some of those. Again, the name of a file and the path to that file are the same. So if I have a file in my documents folder called /user/admin/documents/hello.txt, that is exactly the same as looking at that file in the Finder and navigating to it. It's just that we have our heads so wrapped around the idea of this metaphor of the folder and this metaphor of the document that we sometimes lose sight of the fact that it really is a metaphor. It's a metaphor for a complex data structure that allows the operating system to keep track of all the data that we're storing on the computer. Some files have special properties. A file that has the property of being able to contain other files is referred to as a directory, sometimes referred to more commonly as a folder, right? Here are some commands that deal with directories. PWD, and what I've done here is I've highlighted the letters in the definition of the utility to show you why the command is called what it's called. So hopefully this is demystifying some of that ancient rune aspect of the Unix commands, right? PWD stands for print the working directory. In other words, show me the folder that I'm in right now. LS lists the contents of the directory that you're in, or if you provide another path to the LS command, it will list the contents of that directory. CD stands for change directory, okay? I know these are very basic commands, and I'm sure that many of you have an understanding of these commands, but for those of you that don't, and just type whatever Google says to type. Hopefully this is giving you a little bit of insight. So what does this actually look like? Well, let's string some of these commands together. I want to point out the fact, first of all, that each one of those commands that I just listed has its own man page, has its own manual. This is the man page for print working directory. There's not a lot of information here because it's a very, very simple utility. But there is information nonetheless. For those of you that don't know, by the way, to get out of a man page, you just hit the letter Q, right? You just quit to get back to what's called a normal command prompt. So that's what I'm doing at the end. This is the man page for LS. Notice that underneath the synopsis, we've got what looks like basically the entire alphabet twice. That alphabet represents arguments that you can use on the LS command. In other words, modifications to the LS command that will allow you to get different types of information. It allows you to sort the information. Okay? Notice that also at the bottom of the LS command, there was an example of how to use the command. Man pages often have an example of how you would properly use the syntax in the command. When I typed man cd, notice that I didn't get a manual page for cd. What I got was this other page called built-in. These are commands that are built into the bash shell. Cd command isn't really its own utility. It is a set of instructions, but that set of instructions lives inside the bash shell because it's such a common function. CD stands for change directory. In other words, move to a different folder than the one that I'm currently in on the system. So now let's actually use some of those commands. If I type pwd, it looks like I'm in /admin. If I type ls, that's going to list the contents of the current directory. That's going to show me my folders. Notice that I'm still getting that colorized text. My folders are showing in blue. My executable file is showing in pink. If I type ls and then type in a different file path, that's actually going to show me the contents of that folder. So I'm looking inside now of my documents folder, and I'm seeing that file called hello.txt. If I type ls-lsr, notice I get a completely different listing of the information. And those are the arguments that I was just talking about. The lowercase l tells the computer to list out the file names with all this extra information, the permissions, the owner and the group owner, the date of its creation, the timestamp, okay? Really good stuff. This is just another look at that same information, a different sort. This is actually showing me the invisible files. It's showing me sorted in chronological order. All of these sorts are possible and capable by adding different arguments to the ls command. And again, think back to that analogy to Finder, right? In the Finder, you can sort your files by date, by name, by when they were created, right? By modified date. All those same options are available here in Bash. That's where those functions come from. So here's some more commands for navigating the file system. Make a directory. Again, make mkdir. We all know that that's not a normal English word. But the reason they've used that abbreviation is because back in the day when they were creating these Unix utilities, when they were actually writing the Unix operating system, they had extremely limited resources in terms of what the computer could do. Small amounts of memory, right? So the utility had to be light on its feet and it had to be efficient. That's the reason that OS X still uses the Unix today, is because it's so efficient at what it does. So make a directory. RM. Remove directories and files from the file system. Be careful with this one. I was going to show a video of what happens. I couldn't find one. I should have made one in a virtual machine. But a video of what happens when you run rm-rf/ on a computer. It's actually kind of fun. If you ever have a computer that you can blow up, I highly recommend it. touch. Touch allows you to create a blank file or to change a file's timestamp. That's kind of a big deal, right? You might want to actually be able to manipulate the modified time or the date it was created. So what does some of this stuff look like? Well, there's an ls. I'm in that same directory. Now I'm making a folder called happy folder. When I run the ls command again, now you're seeing that I also have that happy folder that I just created. Now I'm going to use the touch command. The touch command allows me, remember, to create a blank file. So I'm creating a file called happy file. I ls again, notice it's showing me the colorized text. My file is in green, my directories are in blue, my executables are in pink. Now I'm doing rm, I'm removing the happy file. When I run the list command again, happy file goes away. It's literally that simple, right? And just as long as you're thinking about that analogy to Finder, it's no different than making a folder and dragging a folder to the trash. Now I'm making a file called happy file inside the happy folder. How did I do that? Well, I did that by calling out the file path. I said I want to actually create the file inside of the happy folder. That was just a clear, so you can clear the text if your window gets full. Now I'm listing the contents of the happy folder, and notice that I have the happy file in there. Now I'm running some arguments on ls to show me the permissions of the happy file, the owner of the happy file. That last command that I entered, cd dot dot, that allows you to back out one directory. So if you cd, you can change to a directory you call out. If you cd, you go back out one directory from the one that you're in. In other words, backwards on the path, forwards on the path. Make sense? Cool. Move a file to a different directory and copy a file to a different directory. Again, these are things that we do in OS X all the time in the graphical interface without thinking about it. What does this look like? I'm going to copy that file called file to the happy folder. Notice that the file in my admin directory was left untouched. And now if I cd to the happy folder and ls, it shows the file that I moved in. Now I'm going to move the file. And I'm going to move it to my desktop. Hopefully this will make this make sense. Look what I just did. I just made a file on the desktop from the command line, right? The command line is tied directly into the graphical user interface. If you are able to see the files in Finder where you're making these changes in Bash, you will see them represented in the graphical user interface. If I remove the file, it will go away, which I think is what I did next. Oh, I'm actually moving it. And I'm moving it to my admin directory. There it goes. So if you want to practice this stuff, this is really great practice. Make sure that you're moving files to and from your desktop so you can actually see the results of what you've done, right? It's extremely handy to be able to practice in that way. And I strongly urge you, if you have I was just kind of joking about having a computer that you can blow up, but if you do have a computer that you can use with OS X on it to use, just use a computer that you don't care about that you can actually break, right? You can't really figure out how to do stuff without breaking stuff. And it's so helpful to be able to actually see what these things do. And you can totally screw up the operating system. I mean, I'm not going to say that you can't. You can totally screw up the operating system. But the worst thing that can happen is that you're going to be reloading the operating system on a computer that you don't care about. So set up a test environment for yourself. History is actually a command. It shows a list of recently used commands. And you can also use the arrow keys on your keyboard to go backwards and forwards through your command history, and I'll show you that in a second. Two really, really handy commands, and these are commands that are actually good both in the Bash environment and in most word processing environments in OS X, Control A and Control E. If you've never used this and you're typing notes right now, do it right now, because I guarantee you that you will be using these commands once you figure out what they do. It lets you go all the way to the end of a line and append it, or all the way to the beginning of a line and add text there without having to cursor or click on the mouse. It lets you just navigate through the line. Another super important command in Bash is Control C. That will cancel whatever you're doing. For instance, if you're running a script that's doing something bad, it will halt whatever process you're running, and it will give you a new prompt, a new command line to enter more commands. So let's take a look at some of that stuff. So here's the history command. Notice that it actually shows me in the order that I added them. If I had 2,000 commands, it would show me all of them. And now I'm using the arrow keys to actually run through those commands. So if you want to test something and you want to do it over and over again, really the easiest way to do that is just to use the arrow keys to go back up to the commands that you just entered and run that same command again. Here's an example of using Control A and Control E, right? I'm popping back and forth between the beginning of this line and the end of this line. I guarantee you, you will get this and what it's good for once you start using it. Control A and Control E are your best friends, your bestest buddies. And finally, I have another LS. Last thing I want to mention here is tab completion, right? I don't always have to type out an extended file path. If I have a file path that's 13 folders in, I probably don't want to type the whole thing out. And what are the chances I'm going to type the whole thing correctly anyway? Pretty low. Tab completion, again, using the power of the shell, the fact that we can actually, the computer can actually read the binaries and files and the names of the directories for you, using the tab key to complete commands allows you to validate what you're doing while you're navigating through the file system. Because if you hit tab and nothing happens, that means the file that you're looking for isn't actually there. Sorry. And tab completion, again, is your friend. Did I go all the way back to the beginning? That's awesome.
What's the command for that?
Apparently, I don't know, but I can shake the remote around again and see if I can figure it out. All right, let's see if we're back where we need to be here. Cool. Let me go ahead. Tab completion. So we're going to see this one run again. Okay, so some advanced file properties and commands. Want to just touch on this briefly. I don't have any demos of this, but because it's, again, I felt like this was maybe slightly too deep of a topic to get into, but I'm sure that these are commands that you've confronted, things that you've had to deal with. Change mode. Sometimes people refer to this as chmod. I'm not a big fan of trying to pronounce these things in, I mean, they're not words, right? So I prefer to refer to what they actually do than what they actually look like. But if it helps you to remember, and if it gives you Unix street cred to say chmod like all the cool kids do, that's cool. But chmod stands for change mode, right? So what you're actually doing is altering file permissions and access control lists and access control entries. File ownership, chown, again, is another one of these portmanteaus. It stands for change the ownership of the file. So we can change permissions, access control lists with change mode, and change ownership and group ownership with chown or change owner. File permissions determine how files are accessed and used. Typically, there are three what are referred to as octets that control the access of users and groups and the mode itself, how the operating system and how users can write the file, read the file, and execute the file. So you may, back when we were looking at those LS commands, when you saw all that crazy RWX, RWX at the when you run an LS and you see all the very first column is showing you the file permissions based on owner, group, and mode. And of course, access control lists, access control entries, those give you further control over how users can access particular directories and files. File permissions greatly impact computer performance and security. It's something that you need to learn about as an administrator, especially if you're administrating something like a file server or even a JSS server. File permissions are important. File ownership further defines file system access. And it speaks more to the idea of users on a system. Users with limited privileges have different levels of access to files and directories than those with elevated privileges. Some of you may have used the command sudo. Again, some people say sudo, like it rhymes with judo. I'm not here to bag on anyone's pronunciation. I just prefer to use the word to mean what it actually does. Sudo stands for super user do. In other words, temporarily become the super user of the computer or the root user. That's what I mean by elevated privileges, right? You're temporarily becoming someone that has more access to the system than your current user. All right, I had to do this. I'm not a big fan of memes, but this is my favorite one. Again, going back to this idea of having a test environment, if you're going to run scripts and tests and play with stuff, probably don't do it on your production computer, right? Certainly don't do it on a server that's actually a production server that work needs to be done on. It might actually break something in your environment. This guy is pretty cool, but don't be this guy. I want to touch briefly on the concept of a text editor. I want to talk a little bit about scripting and talk a little bit about loops. A text editor is a program that eases the process of joining strings of consecutive commands into scripts. You may have downloaded some awesome script that's supposed to do something on Google and not exactly have it do what you needed it to do. How do you edit it and make changes to that script so that it actually does what you needed to do, so that it's specific to your environment? If you don't have something like a text editor to use to do that, you're going to be in for a world of hurt. Another thing to realize is that what text editors do that are meant for writing code and for scripting, they don't add extra junk formatting text into the document itself. Don't write your scripts in Microsoft Word documents. I'm hearing chuckling, so that's good. Not because you shouldn't use Microsoft Word, but because Microsoft Word adds a bunch of junk formatting text to the text, which the Bash shell will actually attempt to interpret. Right? The Bash shell is very literal. It will attempt to interpret what you feed it. Here are just some examples of text editors. If you're an old gray-bearded Unix administrator, you use Vim. That's really the only one that gives you any street cred. If you're like me, I prefer to actually use something that makes sense to my human brain. Nano, Pico, those three are available in the Bash shell. So if you type the command sudo nano, and then whatever your file might be, if it's a text file, you can actually edit that file directly in line in terminal. Many components of the Casper suite also have inline script editing capability, right? The Composer has a built-in script editor. The JSS itself has a built-in script editor. So there's lots of places where you can use text functional text editors and get access to them. TextEdit is probably a good alternative, although make sure that if your TextEdit will also add formatting to a document. If you're using TextEdit to write your scripts, make sure you're creating it as a plain text document. In other words, don't add anything to the document except for text. And of course, we've got Text Wrangler, BB Edit. Text Wrangler is the free version of BB Edit. Text Wrangler is the one that I really, really like. It's essentially a test environment. It colorizes the text so you can see things like open and closed parentheses. Text Wrangler is free, and it's pretty awesome. So scripting. Bash and other command line interpreters will read executable files that contain commands intended to automate complicated tasks, right? That's what a script is. A script is, people think, oh, I need to write a script. This is so complex. This is so hard. A script is just a bunch of commands strung together. And there's a way of communicating to the shell that you want this file to be read as a script. In other words, you're telling the computer, this is an executable file. This executable file contains instructions that you are to read and execute. That's really as simple as it gets. And again, again, the command line interface rests on top of the OS kernel. And what that really means is that the Bash shell or any command line interpreter can perform OS functions at any or every level of the file system. The shebang. Okay, so I'm sure a lot of you have seen this at the beginning of a script. You may have seen it say something other than /bin/bash. You may have seen it say something like /bin/sh or /bin/csh or /bin/user/python or whatever. The shebang is simply a line that you put at the top of the script that informs the shell that this is to be interpreted as a script. It's not complex. It's basically just saying, hey, this is a script. Whatever's below this, interpret it and run these commands. Finally, we want to talk about loops. A loop is a programming device that allows a computer to iterate repetitively over data that is given to the computer. Loops are used extensively in computer programming. And in Bash, they're very, very powerful tools for operating system and file manipulation. Okay, so let's actually take a look at this. So I'm going to look at my admin, at my documents folder. And in my documents folder, I have two files, one called happy, one called hello.txt. Okay. I'm going to back out of that directory. So I'm going to go back to my users admin directory. And now I'm going to cd to my downloads folder. In my downloads folder, I happen to have a script that I know is going to do something. What the script is going to do is read the contents of a directory and output the file names in that directory to a text file. Now, that might not seem all that useful, but that's actually an incredibly powerful thing. The computer is reading the contents of the directory, capturing all the file names, and printing them out into a text file. I could do the exact opposite with a similar script. I could read a text file and turn that into directories. Once you start realizing that the computer is actually reading the files that you're creating, hopefully that will give you some insight into what you can do with Bash. It's incredibly powerful. This is my script. So notice that I'm using the touch command to create three files. I'm using the make directory command, to create a folder called special directory. And I'm running a loop there that's going to iterate over the contents of that directory and print out a text file. And here it is. Here's the moment where I run this awesome script, and nothing happened. So what's so great about this script? Well, in the Bash environment, usually when you see this kind of thing after you've run your script, it's kind of a no news is good news. If something bad has happened, you're probably going to see an error. When you just see another command prompt, that's essentially an exit zero, meaning, hey, I just did what you asked me to do. Now, how do I actually see the results of that? Well, let's run the script again. And this time, I'm going to show you the desktop. And hopefully, this will give you some visual reference for what the script is actually doing. So I'm going to execute the script with an sh command. It created a directory on my desktop. Inside that directory, it created a file called filelist.txt. And that text file actually contains the contents of the files that I created and the files that were already there. I did that by using a loop to iterate over the contents of that directory. Does that make sense? Questions? Now is the time to ask anything you've always wanted to know about Terminal, but you're too afraid to ask your colleagues or your boss, unless he or she is here, like mine is. So I won't be asking any questions. But you guys ask us questions, whatever you got. I know we don't have that much time, but we've got about 15 minutes. So let's get a discussion going. Yes?
It's not more of a question. It's more of an observation, something I discovered. I work for an education system. One of the things you might notice is for installing older apps that don't want to install on the new operating system, where you say it's a PowerPC app, I can't do anything. Well, I've discovered that it's not really a PowerPC app. The installer that made it was a PowerPC app. You can do a command line installation of some of these older things and get them to run on like 10.9. I discovered this year when I had to put a Final Cut Pro 4 on a bunch of 10.9 machines, and I got it running. So
that's a great point, and I think that maybe the larger point there is that, again, think back to this idea in Unix that everything is a file. Anything that you've got installed on a computer can be pulled apart and broken down into its constituent pieces, right? And you should be able to do, the more you know, you should be able to do whatever you want, essentially, with those constituent pieces. Do you have anything to add to that? No. Anyone else? Good point. I think that I was more making an analogy between deleting a file and removing the file using bash. When you are moving a file to the trash can in Finder, you're essentially just moving that file to a temporary location, right? You're just moving it to a directory. So there's a script that runs, essentially, in OS X that says, OK, this person just clicked on this file and moved it to the trash can. Let's change the directory of that file to this temporary location, which is referred to as the trash. Again, all of these things are metaphors. And once you kind of wrap your mind around the fact that these incredibly great metaphors are potentially screwing up our understanding of what's actually happening at the system level, you'll be able to use the command line more effectively. Yes.
There's a comment and a question. Does TextWrangler have any type of debug function to it? And if not, does what could you recommend? And the only thing I'll mention about the scripting is, unlike the OS, it doesn't say.
Right.
The question
was, does TextWrangler have any debug function? And it has fairly low-level debug function that I briefly touched on. One thing that's cool is when you look at, I don't have one to show you, unfortunately, but when you look at a script in a TextWrangler file, it will actually indicate, if you've got a line that requires quoting or a line that requires parentheses around a certain statement, it will actually indicate to you whether or not the parentheses are closed. In other words, it'll say, hey, this line only has an opening parentheses. It doesn't have a closing parentheses. That's essentially a debugging function. It does. And in fact, in TextWrangler, you can actually run your script. It actually provides a testing environment that will, it provides a bash shell, essentially, that will let you, TextWrangler will essentially run the script in this test environment. So I highly recommend it. Again, it's free. I use it constantly. Yes, and I'll come back to you.
Is there any good resources that helps to explain where PLS files are affecting the system? Because, for example, I'll know that I want a particular outcome, but I'm not even sure which PLS I should be looking for, and whether there's an easy way to write a variable into that PLS file.
The great thing is if you have the Casper suite, you actually have a tool for discovering PLS built right into the Composer app. If you use the, there are three methods of creating packages in Composer, right? You've got the normal snapshot, you've got the new and modified snapshot, and then you've got the file system event. In my working days as a system administrator, I never used the file system event package creation for building packages. But what I did use it for is finding out what file system events were running on the system when I wanted to try something, to find something like exactly like you're describing. I know there's a plist that's being created somewhere in a directory, but I have no idea where it is. If you run the file system event package builder and then perform your installation or perform your function or whatever, that should capture every file system event. I want to give you one caution about this, though. Modifying plist was something that was a widely held practice in the past. It's maybe not as, I shouldn't say it's not condoned, because there are reasons to do it, but because of the changes that Apple has made in OS 8 and OS 10.8 and 10.9 in regard to the way preferences are cached, you have to be a little careful about modifying plists. You can still do what you're trying to do, and you are correct in saying what you said, but you're going to want to maybe do a little studying on the cfprefsd, which is the daemon that controls where plist information actually gets stored. In other words, direct modification of the plists is no longer as effective as it used to be, because there's now a cache where that information is stored. So If you have more questions about that, I'd be happy to. There's a daemon that's responsible for updating preferences on the system called cfprefsd. Yeah, and I can actually answer questions about that. It's a little bit of a deeper topic, but good question. Correct. The good thing about you, so that's correct. So defaults, the defaults command, which is an Apple utility built into OS X, does allow this daemon that's responsible for refreshing the preference lists to actually do its thing. If you just directly manipulate the plist, you are bypassing that system that that Apple has built into OS X to manage plists. So you're on the right track. Yeah. I do. Speak of the devil. So I love Cryptid.com. Charles Edge now works for us, which is really, really exciting. And I was so excited when I heard Charles Edge is going to work at Jamf. I'm like, oh my god, you know. I the first time I rode with him in the elevator, I was actually like having kind of a brush with greatness moment. I'm like, every time I'm trying to figure something out, the answer is on your blog. So Cryptid.com, pretty amazing. Their flounder, Rich Trouton presented yesterday here at this conference. An amazing bunch of resources on his website. AFP 548, which is another SysMac systems administrator site. I like Ars Technica just for general technical information a lot. They have really in-depth articles, especially really great analysis on when new versions of OS X come out and iOS 8, Ars Technica really digs in hard. So a lot of great information there. These are two Bash tutorials that I really, really like. The first one is using Bash, and the second one is specifically on writing scripts. And they're both easy to understand, tons of examples, common sense, straightforward information, both really highly recommended if you're curious about this stuff. This is my favorite book on Unix for two reasons. One, this book is awesome. It actually comes with a disk that allows you to set up a Linux environment on a computer if you don't have one. And two, because of this guy's picture. I've never seen someone so unhappy to have their picture taken for the cover of a book. So that's why I had to make it bigger, just so I could show you that. But this book is amazing. And really, this was how my first forays into this stuff, this book was like my Bible. So awesome. Can't recommend it enough. And Apple has amazing resources. They have on developer.apple.com, and you don't have to be a member of the developers program to get to this. It's just available on the developer site. Shell scripting introduction. It's incredible. Free resource, super, super, super in-depth. And the great thing about it is that it's specific to OS X, right? Those other two Bash tutorials that I had up there, those are generic. So the examples may be written in a version of Linux that's not quite exactly the same as the Bash shell in OS X. Apple's scripting introduction is for OS X. Also, the Bash page, right? Don't forget about the Bash, man Bash. You can get there not only by typing man Bash into terminal, you can also get there on the web. Most man pages for Unix utilities can be found on developer.apple.com. So these slides are going to be available. I know some of you are taking pictures of them. Slides are going to be available posted, so all these links will be available as well. And these are awesome resources. Great. Thank you for asking that question. That's up there. Thank you. I'm thanking you anyway, but we can continue to. How do you mean? Oh, my strategy for that, and other people may have different strategies, but you know, terminal allows you to open multiple tabs. So I would always have the man page open in one tab and the thing I was doing in the other.
The other alternative is you highlight the word, right-click on it, and the contextual menu will give you open man page, and it'll do it in a separate.
Yep, so you can also have the man page in a completely separate terminal window, which is a great tip. Was there someone over here? Yes. Yep. Awesome.
One over here.
For me, depends on what you want to do. There are some limitations that you get into with Bash, and I'm not the one to speak exhaustively about this. I would say 95% of what I need to do, I can do in Bash, so I just use that. I can do all my basic loops. I can do if-then statements. I can do whiles, untils, like all of this kind of basic contextual or basic logic. Bash supports it all. It's not until you start getting into, I don't think it does multi-dimensional arrays or things like that.
Well, maybe the newer version does, but
the newer,
yeah.
But you know, as a sysadmin, most of what I need to do is I need to get this one file from this location on the operating system over to this location on the operating system, and I need to do that on 5,000 machines. So a 3 or 4 line shell script, throw that into your JSS, push it out with a policy, takes care of it. So that's the majority of my scripting, to be honest.
I mean, it is the default shell, so I totally agree with that statement that 95% of what can be done with Bash. I guess I'll say one other thing. The only reason I mention this is because I was just having this conversation with another member of our team this morning. Once you start getting into this stuff and doing it, then you want to do everything in Bash, right? And then the more complicated your ideas get, the more complicated your Bash scripts get. And at that point, you might want to consider leaving Bash, because I would draw an analogy to baking bread, right? If you want to bake bread, you can go to the grocery store and you can buy flour and you can buy salt and mix it together at home. If you want to bake bread using Bash, the analogy would be you'd have to mine the salt and maybe like grind the flour and grow the wheat, right? So the more complex programming languages have more stuff built into the libraries and functions that they use. Bash is really a bare bones environment. So I would say Bash is great for doing simple systems administrative tasks. Once you want to actually get into programming, probably want to look at something else like Python or Ruby or any number of possibilities out there.
I'm sure if we would have said that at the API session yesterday, we would have seen 200 hands go up. You should use Perl or
Perl.
Ruby.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Everyone has their favorite.
Yep.
Anyone else? Nobody? All right. Well, I'm going to hang out up here if anybody has any questions. Again, these resources are going to be available online. I know this session was really, really basic, but that was the idea. We did 2 sessions on scripting last year that were a slightly more complex topic, so I wanted to just have one that really addressed this need, and I hope it was worthwhile and that you got some good information out of it.